Hello, StarkNet fam. This is Nurstar speaking, and welcome to the second episode of Meet the Foundation, a monthly edition of the Stark Cafe show, where we explore the mission of the StarkNet Foundation and the activities that they're bringing forward in order to boost growth and development in the StarkNet ecosystem. In this episode, we'll have the pleasure to speak to Damien about the overall growth practices in the StarkNet ecosystem and beyond. And together with him, we'll have an overview of the recent StarkNet hackathon organized by the foundation in Istanbul. So first of all, let's give him a warm welcome. Hello, Damien. Welcome to the Star Cafe. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you very much for having me, Nastar. Very excited to be joining you. Hello, everyone.
Let's start with an introductory question. So would you mind telling us a bit about your background and your overall Web3 journey? How did you find out about StarkNet? And also, what motivated you to accept the head of growth at the head of growth role at the StarkNet Foundation? Did you hear my question, Damon?
Oh, sorry. I ended up going on mute. Sorry. Now I completely forgot what I was saying. Oh, yeah. Quick correction. I'm not the head of growth at the foundation. My role is actually the growth lead. The foundation is currently hiring for a head of growth. So if anyone listening here thinks they have the credentials to come into this role, we have a recruiter called Kim that works for the foundation. Send her an email with your resume and let them know. On my side, I started my Web3 journey as a corporate lawyer. So I was practicing in public markets, which primarily just sort of means takeovers and IPOs. Life was pretty good when I was doing this, but I sort of felt like something a little bit was missing. I guess now looking back, it is like a bit more meaning and passion. And so when COVID hit, back when I was still practicing, I was in this weird place where I could sort of had all the downsides of doing corporate law. Without any of the upsides. So none of the nice client dinners or the nice closing deal parties. Looking back, it's actually a great thing for me because it catalyzed me to look at something else. But back then it was a little bit grim. Anyway, so I went down the crypto rabbit hole. I got really into DeFi Summer. I then asked to swap to my firm's crypto regulation practice. So I was very fortunate there. Worked there for about 6 months before going straight into a head of BD role at a DeFi protocol on Solana. We raised a seed round. We then raised like a Series A. We even scaled to be like the biggest DEX or the biggest perps DEX on Solana before I took up this role as the growth lead at the foundation.
Pretty well. And when you were offered this, when you applied also for this role, which were your considerations about the StarkNet ecosystem, also your knowledge about it, and what motivated you to get this role, even though you were coming from a different background, you know?
Yeah, that's a great question. To be honest, my experience with outside of the Solana ecosystem when I came across StarkNet was relatively limited. I had a very chance encounter, and I managed to meet Ellie as he was sort of hiring for various roles to start the foundation. And at the very beginning, he was just sort of looking for someone who could do general ops. So some of my first tasks were preparing finding legal counsel, just really the very beginnings of starting a foundation, choosing our committee members, putting together their contracts, finding our lawyers, finding our tax advisors, all of those really small things that people don't really consider when they think about what's necessary when you start up a foundation. I was very fortunate because through those things, I got to have weekly calls with the board members. So at the time I was speaking a lot with Ellie from Starkware, Tomash from Nethermind, and also Andrew McLaughlin from, I'm actually not sure which company he's from right now, but he's the ex-CTO of the United States government. And so these were all extremely impressive and high credentialed people that I had never had the opportunity to speak with at such a intimate setting before. And so after these weekly calls, I just really got sold on the people. And I'm relatively maybe sporadic's a word, but I like to go all in on things that I believe in. And so I really believed in their vision, what they thought StarkNet could become. And so I jumped right into it when they offered me a full-time role.
I see. Very impressive. First of all, also, thanks a lot for specifying the fact that, you know, you're the growth lead at the Stuckner Foundation, and that's a different role than the head of growth. You know, it's a bit easy to get the two roles confused. And but thanks a lot for the clarification. And yeah, having said that, yeah, let's jump into the topic of growth, and which is a huge one when it comes to the blockchain field, due to the fact that there is a lot of potential in terms of technological innovation and financial upside that often stimulates growth, while there are also many obstacles, right, to growth, such as regulatory uncertainty, hacks, scams, etc. So according to your own experience and also to your own legal experience as a lawyer, how do you see growth practices and strategies in Web3, generally speaking, and how can we improve them? So also, what kind of growth principles would you like to suggest to Stuckner projects so that they can grow faster, but still in a sustainable and safe way?
Yeah, great question. I think there's a distinction between growth for Starknet projects, like what should projects building on Starknet do to optimize for growth and end users, and versus what should the foundation do to grow the pie and to grow the Starknet ecosystem. On the latter one, so what the foundation should do, it's a really hard question to answer right now. Like the way that the ecosystem is growing, Starkware, which was the original company that created this technology and has incubated this ecosystem, they're I think 150 person strong team that primarily works in person, has an amazing culture, and has sort of like with their own hands like blossomed this ecosystem to where it is today. The foundation, on the other hand, is like, I think at this stage we're 9 full-time members, or perhaps 10. And so I guess the point I'm going for there is growth for the foundation at this stage is really just trying to pick up as much stuff as we can that's being taken care of by Starkware and carry it as far as we can. So either iterate on top of it, either adopt it, or either do it at the very least as well as they're currently doing it. So growth, at least for the past, I would say, 4 to 6 months, has very much been about upskilling and ramping up on resources and taking over as much responsibility as we can. In terms of broader growth initiatives that the foundation, I guess, has put in place or is currently putting in place, there's a lot of different programs that have happened and are currently happening, right? There was the EAG program, which was the Early Adopters Grants program. That was, I think, an initial grant that was allocated to programs deployed on-chain on Starknet. And that was overseen by the EAG committee, which was a series of committee members that were appointed by the foundation. At the moment, I think what just closed last night, if I'm not mistaken, is the ECMP program. So the Early Community Members program, which is, if you guys haven't applied, you definitely should have applied. But it was a way to reward community members that have contributed to the growth of Starknet to date. What's happening in the background at the moment as well that I'm working on is the DeFi committee. So the DeFi committee is set up specifically for the growth of the DeFi vertical on Starknet. There are various verticals that deserve attention and they all should deserve attention, but DeFi is, of course, one of, the verticals on blockchain in general that has the most amount of PMF. And so it's a big, very big focus for us as well, and hence why we have allocated specific resources to grow there. But in general, that's a very long-winded response. I'm not sure what the most correct one is. I guess what I'm saying is growth is different in different stages, and there are different growth initiatives specifically for different verticals. For the last, like, let's say 6 months or so, our growth was very much just on upskilling on our capability and our capacity. And now that I think we're like kind of there and we're doing a lot of different things, like we're now focusing on specific initiatives that will grow specific verticals on Starknet.
Fair enough, Damien. And I confirm that the ECMP closed last night at midnight UTC. And so for those listeners who like forgot to apply, unfortunately, the damage is done. But yeah, you also mentioned, you know, some initiatives that were in the direction of growth, such as the early adoption grants program, together with the, you know, ECMP program. They also, like, we're going to see a lot of very interesting activities related to DeFi, as we were saying. And also, I suppose that also in like in the near future, especially like next year or, you know, in the next 6 months, we'll also start seeing something like a contributors program, right? Also to attract skillful contributors into Starknet. What do you think?
Yeah, exactly. And also, I want to say that there's much more in the background as well that's happening. And if anyone here needs any sort of particular support or wants to learn more about any particular initiative, to just reach out to me. Like, I try to be as available as I can and try to be as responsive as I can. There's a lot of stuff that's actually happening that people may not know of. Like, for example, the developer relations team. So that's overseen by Henri. Who's moved over from Starkware. They have a series of really, really great initiatives that are designed to onboard and grow the number of developers within the Starknet ecosystem. And that's done with his team of developer advocates. They have like a series of base camps that's run across like a 3 to 4 week period, I believe, which takes developers from 0 to 1 on learning Cairo. They're currently running mentorship programs for, I guess, company builders that need more help on the technical side, or perhaps need more help on the business side, to pair them with someone experienced within Starknet. I myself just ran a bunch of initiatives in Istanbul with our Hacker House and Starknet CC, and it's something that was a relative success, so I'm looking to replicate for the next year. So if you're a builder in Starknet today, like, there are a lot of ways for you to get involved and a lot of ways for you to receive support. The only thing we're lacking is perhaps information on all of these things. So if you want to know more information about it, just reach out to me.
Very well. And if there's someone of you guys from the audience who would like to ask Damien for a question, feel free to write them in the comment. And then, yeah, right now I will actually like to give you a surprise. You know, as live listeners, you can now mint the spoke. You can now claim the spoke brought to you by you know, by our friends at Argent and Unframed. So you can claim it in the comment sections. You will find the link, and yeah, enjoy it. I hope you like it, and thanks a lot once again for being here. And well, you were speaking about you know, the Starknet Hackathon in Istanbul, and we saw you in a very good shape presenting, you know, presenting on the stage the different projects, introducing workshops, and also, you know, having a role in the Starknet CC that took place a couple of days later. And yeah, first of all, I wanted to know your overall experience during the Istanbul weeks. And then also, if you would like to highlight something from the Starknet Hackathon, what impressed you the most? If you would like to mention some projects that you know, the you know, they caught your attention with and then yeah, maybe having like some examples and stuff like that.
Yeah. Istanbul in general, I personally think was a really great success. And I'm very proud and happy with how it went. If you guys were there, like, I hope you guys enjoyed it as much as I did. And it's something that I'm looking to replicate for next year as well. So in terms of which ones were impressive, maybe I'll give an overview of how we ran the Hacker Houses this time around. So going into the Istanbul Hacker House, we knew that people building within Starknet are already extremely talented, right? Like, the tech stack self-curates for a specific set of developers that are extremely smart and understand the tech at a very deep level and are very passionate about blockchain and decentralization and immutability. I think going into it, something that we wanted to solve for was, how can we structure this talent in a way where when they come out of the Hacker House, they tangibly have something? Like, it's not just, oh, I've spent 5 days here, it was a great experience, it was a lot of fun, but that they come out of it and they're like, I'm deeper in the ecosystem than I was 5 days ago. Or I know more things about the ecosystem and I can do more things with this new knowledge than I did 5 days ago. So from that baseline, what we wanted to design for the 5 days was a series of, I guess, a competitive aspect where projects had to build every day and had to check in with their mentors, mentors being OGs within the Starknet ecosystem that were assigned per team, and had to actually report to these mentors like, hey, like, today I think I'm going to build XYZ. And the mentors would sort of enter into this back and forth with them every morning, being like, hey, I think you can actually build more than that. Or, hey, I think this is a little bit too ambitious and maybe you should try and think of something else. And then in the afternoon, mentors would have another check-in with these projects and actually see what they built. Did they do what they said they were going to do? Did they run into any problems? Did they creatively solve those problems? Did they sort of just give up and, you know, sit around and eat snacks for the rest of the afternoon? And based on that afternoon check-in, these projects were assigned a score publicly. So there was a leaderboard and they were scored out of 10, and you could see very publicly where you ranked based on your performance that day. And then across the number of days of the Hacker House, what that sort of created was this environment of competitiveness where people wanted to score higher, and people wanted to impress their mentors, and people wanted to actually do really well with the skill set that they had. So at the end of the Hacker House, what we had was a list of projects ranked from 1 to 30, because we had 30 projects participating. And we took the top 10 and we're like, now you get 5 minutes and 1 minute question time to present this afternoon in front of a full room of just external random people. Like, they were comprised of VCs, other DevConnect attendees, other ecosystem players, a bunch of people from like centralized exchanges, just people that they otherwise wouldn't have had an opportunity to speak in front of. And we were like, you have an afternoon to prepare. And that was like a really great incentive. Like, people really worked hard to be part of the top 10. And the top three from that night then got to present at Starknet CC the next day in front of 400 or so people. So it was like setting a series of rewards in place for really good behavior, and that good behavior being genuine work being done during this Hacker House. Overall, it worked out like relatively well, I think. And it's something that I'm very excited to try and push and replicate again in the coming years, or in the coming year. And hopefully it becomes like a new tool we have in our toolkit for developer onboarding, developer maturation, and company building.
Amazing. Yeah, I must say that, you know, even so I wasn't there, but, you know, I'm Nurstar, so my ears are everywhere when it comes to Starknet. And I heard wonders about the Starknet Hackathon. And like, obviously, yeah, let's give a shout out to all the organizers and, you know, all the mentors who made this hackathon possible. Like, also, for example, I know that Gurkha, our friend Gurkha, put an immense effort in organizing it. So thanks a lot, guys, if you're listening to us. And having said that, you know, also I really like the fact that you introduced the role of mentors, you know, and I think that they created a lot of, you know, engagement with the, also it helped creating this kind of connection between teams. And I'm sure that mentors gave a lot of very wise advice and you know, and help projects putting turning an idea into a project. And I wanted to to ask you regarding also the, you know, the future in the coming months. We'll be seeing a lot of different events taking place around the world. You know, recently IT Global has published their schedule for the next year, including IT Global hackathons in Sydney, Singapore, London, and then in San Francisco. So I wanted to know what you're planning. Like, we'll be able to see some more exciting hackathons. Like, for example, in London in March, which is going to be the first IT Global hackathon of the year after the one in IT Denver. So yeah, let's tell us a bit about the future, if you can, and yeah, we're very excited about that.
Yeah, I'm also very excited. I unfortunately have to let you down a little bit and say that we have not confirmed which locations we'll be doing this at next year. I'm hoping to have this confirmed by sometime next week. I think right now, like, what we're flirting between is like thinking about around 4 or so Hacker Houses next year. The specific locations, the specific dates are still in contention, and there's a bit of debate going back and forth. But I'm hoping I can get a firm answer to you relatively soon. And we'll make a formal post about it. We'll, right now I'm waiting for the after movie from the Istanbul Hacker House. And so once we have that, we're going to post that along with all of the winners and all of the projects that we're building. And then after that, we'll post our plans for 2024. But coming soon is all I can say.
That's great, Damien. Looking forward to it. And I've actually run out of questions, and I also wanted to make this session quite light because we're approaching the weekend. But I would also like to read a question from the public, specifically from Fabio Catalão, a very active community member in Brazil, and he wanted to ask you your view about local communities. And how are you thinking to spread content, which is not written and produced in English? So basically, are there any plans to stimulate local exposures?
Yeah, 100% there is, and I don't think there are even plans. I think they're currently being implemented. I think they're actually happening at this stage. So, Fabrico, is it? If you're interested in helping translate content into Portuguese and propagating that in the local Brazilian community, like we have resources in place to help you do that. Specifically, I know the developer advocacy team has in place like a standardized program for how base camps work in English, and they provide all of those materials. Step-by-step instructions for how someone from a local community can translate that into their own language, can run those sessions by themselves, and can track retention and efficiency and all the things that we're tracking as well with our base camps. And you'll get paid to run these sessions. Like these aren't voluntary sessions. Like if you're knowledgeable about Starknet, if you're passionate about spreading the technology within your community, there are programs in place like the one I just said that will support you in, I guess, you supporting us.
Very well. So, guys, we've come to the end of this Meet the Foundation episode, and I had a great time learning more about the growth strategies of the foundation, and also about the Starknet Hacker House that took place in Istanbul 10 days ago. And yeah, first of all, thanks a lot to all the listeners who came here. Remember to claim the pop that you can find in the comment section. And thanks a lot for listening. And obviously, thanks so much to Damien for coming here and to take some of your precious time and to dedicate it to us. Thanks a lot, Damien.
Cool. Thank you very much, Nestor. I'll end with one final message, if that's okay. Like we covered a lot of different discussions in this call today, but I guess the last point I would like to emphasize and leave people with is the way I see my own personal role in growth is very much just around founder support and I guess builder support. I've worked in startups before, I've worked in corporate before. I like to think that at least that I know some of the struggles that most builders will go through because most builders go through similar journeys, whether it's on the regulatory aspect, the hiring aspect, the venture aspect, the like there's a whole bunch of stuff that that happens that isn't as unique to your own building experience as you may think. And so if there's anything that I can do on my side that can help remove hurdles in your builder journey on Starknet, I'm very happy to allocate time to help you do that. I've got my Calendly in my bio on my profile, and part of the reason why I have it there is because if anyone is building on Starknet and does want to talk and just get general advice or introductions or whatever it is, I'm always going to make time for me to be able to help you do that. But yeah, that's generally how I see my role. So if I can be of any help at all, please just reach out.
Thanks a lot, Damien, for keeping your doors always open to the Starknet communities. And I think that you've been doing a great job. So we wish you all the best and all the luck in the next months. And I'm sure you will help us, achieving important goals. So yeah, looking forward to meeting you in person and also to hosting you back at the Star Cafe. Thanks a lot once again to you and to all the listeners. And it's now time to close. Remember to share the Starknet vibe and see you next time. Bye, guys. Bye, Damien. Thanks a lot.
See ya, see ya.